again to repeat, Umar, Ali, Umar, and Ibn Umar, Ibn Mas'ud, Ibn Abbas, Zayd bin Thabit, and Aisha radiallahu anha. And Aisha radiallahu anhum wa an as-sahabati ajma'in. Now after the Sahaba, similarly there were luminaries amongst the Tabi'een that the generality of Tabi'een referred to for their legal rulings. Amongst those individuals, Sa'id bin Musayyib or Musayyib, both pronunciations are related. Sa'id bin Musayyib, Hassan al-Basri, Allah be pleased with all of them. Kharija bin Zayd bin Thabit. There were others, but they were few in numbers. They were not a very large number. After their generation and the generation of the Tabi Tabi'een, you have figures such as Imam Malik. Imam Malik was Tabi Tabi'i. Imam Malik met Nafi', who was the student of Ibn Umar, also Abu Hanifa, Layth bin Sa'd, Sufyan al-Thawri, Sufyan bin Uyayna. Then after their generation, the generation of Imam al-Shafi'i, Muhammad ibn al-Hasan al-Shaybani, Abu Yusuf, who were all mujtahidun in their own rights. The students of Imam Shafi'i, such as Imam, three you see here, Rabi'a, Muzani, Buwaiti, Abu Thawr in Iraq, who had his own school. Imam al-Junaid was a student of Abu Thawr in Fiqh, and Imam Junaid, in some estimations, was in his own right a mujtahid in Fiqh, in addition to becoming one of the foundational figures in Tasawwuf. Imam Dawood al-Zahiri, another student of Imam al-Shafi'i in Iraq, and the Zahiri school, which died out but was revived by Ibn Hazm in his Muhalla. And really, it's the Zahiri or literalist school is effectively the fiqh school of modern-day Salafis. But we'll discuss why it's not considered one of the four schools. Imam Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, the great mufassir, had his own madhab. He was a mujtahid in fiqh. So he was one of the great scholars of the ummah. In addition to being considered the dean of all the Quranic exegists, Imam al-Tabari, his tafsir is one of the earliest extant tafsirs and one of the most voluminous, and he has gathered virtually all of the commentary on the Quran that's been related from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba and Tabi'een in his book. He has over 30,000 narrations in his tafsir, Tafsir Tabari. So in addition to being a great exegete, he was a mujtahid in his own right. So all of these figures, they were mujtahidun and they had their own madhabs. So we repeat some of their names again. So one we didn't mention, Al-Awza'i, in the generation of Imam Malik. Layth bin Sa'd, Imam Malik, Sufyan al-Thawri, Sufyan bin Uyayna, Abu Hanifa, Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani, Abu Yusuf. Those were two companions of Abu Hanifa. Az-Zufar, Z-U-F-A-R, another companion of Abu Hanifa. Imam al-Shafi'i, Imam Ahmed, Abu Thawr, T-H-A-W-R. Dawood al-Zahiri, Dawood the literalist. Imam al-Tabari, and others. All of these were independent schools in their own right. However, only four of these schools survived in the Sunni tradition, and all of those were in the tradition of Ahli Sunnah. Now, the other schools from the Shia, the Ithna Ashari or Ja'fari school in jurisprudence, survived according to some opinions, and the Zaidi school, based primarily in the north of Yemen, around Sana'a, has survived. Now, we're speaking in the Sunni context, only these four survived. And this is why we follow one of these four. Now, a common question in this day and age, because of the skepticism directed towards the following followers of madhahib, is why only these four? When there were other mujtahids, which we mentioned many of them, such as Imam Layth bin Sa'd, Imam Al-Awza'i, Imam Sufyan al-Thawri, Imam Sufyan bin Uyayna, Imam Muhammad, Abu Yusuf, Imam Al-Tabari, Imam Abu Thawr, and others. So why these four? There are two primary distinctions which these four enjoy. One, as we've mentioned, none of the others have been updated by successive generations of scholars. So we show here, and we could do this with the school of Imam Malik, the school of Imam Abu Hanifa, the school of Imam Ahmed. The generations around the foundational figure recorded the principles and rulings of the Imam. Imam Layth, is said, was as knowledgeable or more knowledgeable than Imam Malik. Imam Layth, who died in Cairo, is said to have been as knowledgeable or more knowledgeable than Imam Malik. There was a dispute amongst the ulama, who's more knowledgeable, Layth or Malik? Some said Imam Layth bin Sa'd was more knowledgeable than Imam Malik, but that his students betrayed him. His students did not take the adequate care of his school, his rulings, his principles, so they were lost. They were lost. Other schools were effective, but they were replaced by what people viewed to be more effective, superior schools. For example, Imam Al-Awza'i's school was the dominant school in Syria, Damascus, Palestine, Lebanon, for 200 years, but it was gradually replaced by the school of Imam Shafi'i. The school of Imam Sufyan al-Thawri was the dominant school in southern Iraq, Basra and Kufa, but it was replaced by the school of Abu Hanifa, which the people viewed as being more flexible and more able to deal with the evolving issues that the people were confronted with. Other schools died out in time. Once the school died out, the second, so those schools have not been updated and refined, rarefied by successive generations of scholars. Secondly, more importantly, we don't know with certainty that those schools, what we have of those schools remaining, are in fact the original rulings and methodology of the founder of the school, because they have not been transmitted to us by tawatur. So they have not been transmitted by groups upon groups in successive generations, so that we are certain they didn't collaborate to fabricate what they're narrating, or that they narrated it erroneously, because there are too many people in too many different locations narrating the same thing. So none of those schools, the Zahiri school, the school of Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, the school of Abu Thawr, none of the imams besides these four have been narrated to us by tawatur. And we mentioned last week what tawatur is, groups upon groups in such a way, a configuration, that it's impossible to imagine that they conspired to fabricate what they're narrating. So we have absolute certainty concerning these four schools. From the time of their imams, they were narrated to us in every generation, bitawatur, groups upon groups, until the present day. So these are the two distinctions of these four schools. So having said that, what are some of the textual proofs